Hello viewers, today in our second lesson on inverse trigonometric functions, we will continue our discussions on principal value branch. In our previous lesson, we learned about the sine inverse and the principal value branch of the sine inverse. Why did we have to talk about principal value branch, and why is there so much of emphasis on discussion of the principal value branch? Let's just revisit sine inverse for that and then continue with the other function. What we saw in the previous lesson was that the sine function defined over its entire domain of the set of real numbers is not a one-one function. But if we select sub intervals of the set of real numbers, then the function becomes a one-one function. What we saw was that sine function defined between minus 3 pi by 2 to minus pi by 2, minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2, and so on, is a 1-1 and onto function. And so, we are able to define sine inverse as sine inverse as a function from closed interval minus 1, 1, the range of sine function now becomes the domain of sine inverse, mapped onto the interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, that is the closed interval minus pi by 2, pi by 2, defined as sine inverse of x equal to y if x equal to sine y, and that is known as the principal value branch. You may define sine inverse from minus 1, 1 to any other of those intervals that we just discussed, and the function would remain defined, but is not addressed as the principal value branch. Today, our focus is on the remaining trigonometric functions, starting with cosine function. Can you visualize the graph of cosine function? And now, the task is to define, identify those sub intervals over which the function is 1-1. And when mapped to the range of the cosine function is an onto function. Here we have the graph of cosine function, a wave-like smooth continuous graph defined over the entire real numbers, and the range is between minus 1, 1, close interval minus 1, 1. If you observe it closely, or you use what we discussed last time as a horizontal line test, are you able to identify intervals over which the function is 1, 1, and when mapped to the closed interval minus 1, 1 is onto? I'm sure you are able to see many possibilities. We have here a representation for you. If you see the piece of the graph between say minus 2 pi to minus pi, or minus pi to 0, 0 to pi, pi to 2 pi, the function is very much a 1-1 function, because if you draw a horizontal line across the graph, then it does not cut the graph in more than one point in between these intervals. And therefore, we are ready to define the inverse of cosine over any of these sub intervals over which the function is 1-1 and onto. And so, we are ready to define inverse of cosine function. We have cos inverse function defined from minus 1, 1 close interval to the interval 0 to pi, both 0 and pi included in it, defined as cos inverse of x is equal to y if x is equal to cos y, and this branch is called the principal value branch. If the range is 0 instead of 0 to pi, pi to 2 pi, the cos inverse function is still defined, but it is not called the principal value branch. Let's take a look at the visualization of the cos inverse as a reflection of cos along the line y equal to x. So, let's begin with the line y equal to x, and let's take the graph of cosine function. If I take a point A on it and reflect it along the line y equal to x, I get a point say A dash. Let's see what happens if I trace this point A dash as A moves along the graph. Do you see a wave-like curve coming along the y-axis as well? But this is not what we are looking at as the principal value branch. The principal value branch will only happen when we restrict the interval from 0 to pi. And this pink color branch that you see right now is the cos inverse as a principal value branch of the cosine inverse function. I hope you have now made a note of the emphasis that we are doing on the definition and also on the need for such subintervals to be discussed as we define inverse trigonometric functions. So, are you ready for our third function, cosec x? If I have the cosec function and I want to discuss the inverse of it, I must know what the domain and the range of the cosec functions are and also whether the function is 1, 1, and if not, can I make it 1, 1 or not. Do you know what the domain of cosec function is? Since cosec x is 1 by sin x, cosec x cannot be defined wherever sin x becomes 0. And therefore, domain of cosec function is all real numbers except n pi. That means all multiples of pi cannot be in the domain of cosine function, where n belongs to set of integers. The range of cosec function is set of all real numbers y belonging to R as written here. Y should be greater than equal to 1 or y is less than equal to minus 1. Another way of writing the same set is all real numbers except the open interval minus 1, 1. And because of this special feature of cosec x, the graph also is special. It is not a continuous graph. It is not defined at 0, pi, 2 pi, and therefore there is a break there. And also the range being all real numbers except minus 1, 1 as an open interval leaves a patch in between uncovered. Observe it closely and see if you can identify the subintervals of the domain over which the function is 1, 1. And when mapped to the range of cosec function is an onto function. Again, think of the horizontal line test. Pick regions which are not crossed by a horizontal line more than once. I am sure you are coming up with many answers, and some of those are reflected here. If you take the interval between minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2 and so on, the function is very much a 1, 1 function. And when mapped to its range, the function is 1, 1 and onto. We again are going to define principal value branch of cosec inverse, and we have the principal value branch defined over the interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. And we are ready with the definition of cosec inverse. Cosec inverse is a function defined from all real numbers minus the open interval minus 1, 1, that was a range of cosec function, mapped to the set which is close interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 minus 0, because at 0 cosec was not defined. So, even in the graph at 0 there is no point corresponding to it. So, the principal value branch range would be minus pi by 2 comma pi by 2 minus, that is leaving out 0. And how do we define cosec inverse x? Cosec inverse x is y if x is cosec y, that is the principal value branch of cosec inverse. Now, after a discussion of these three inverse trigonometric functions in detail, I am sure you will be able to figure out the principal value branch for the remaining three functions. I have a ready-made set of values here for you. Please note them down and now go back and maybe think about what the graph looked like and see why have we come up with these as the principal value branches. And so, we have principal value branches of inverse trigonometric functions, all six listed here. The first three were discussed in great detail, and the next three are now written down for you to copy down And also take a look at why are we looking at intervals like 0 to pi minus pi by 2. Sec inverse has the principal value branch with the range 0 to pi minus pi by 2, simply because sec pi by 2 is not defined. So, I have to leave out pi by 2 out of the closed interval 0 to pi. Similarly, when we talk about tan inverse, it will be defined from all real numbers to the interval, open interval, minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, because again all odd multiples of pi by 2 are not in the domain of tan, and therefore, when I talk about the principal value branch of tan inverse, the range will be an open interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. Same reason holds for cot inverse. It is defined over the entire real numbers and mapped onto the open interval 0 to pi. Remember, cot function domain does not have any multiples of pi, and that is how we would be working as we go ahead with some exercises on how to evaluate principal values of a given inverse trigonometric function. So, are you ready for an exercise where we will be using not only one inverse trigonometric function, but three? This table of values and intervals are important. You need to kind of memorize, but if you visualize and see why it has come out to be these now intervals, things will become easier for you. So, we have our next question here. Ready with the pen? Find the value of sec inverse of minus root 2 plus cot inverse of root 3 minus tan inverse of minus 1. It is actually maybe three questions put together in one, can be a simple one marker, not more than one mark definitely. What you need to do is evaluate each three independently, add them, and you have the answer. Beginning with sec inverse minus root 2. If I take y to be sec inverse of minus root 2, then by definition sec of y is minus root 2. Therefore, keeping the principal value branch in mind, y belongs to 0 to pi, leaving out pi by 2. So, which value of y would give me minus root 2? I am looking at the first and the second quadrant except for pi by 2. So, sec y will be negative in the second quadrant, and therefore, it must have a value like y must be pi minus pi by 4, which is nothing but 3 pi by 4. And therefore, the principal value of sec inverse minus root 2 is 3 pi by 4. Similarly, spend a minute thinking about what would be cot inverse of root 3. The first thing that should flash into your mind is, what was the principal value branch range for cot inverse? Open interval 0 to pi. So, if I take y to be same as cot inverse root 3, then I need that y which gives me cot of y to be root 3. Between 0 to pi, the probable answer is pi by 6. For tan inverse of minus 1, the principal value branch has the range as open interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. So, obviously, the angle will be minus pi by 4. And therefore, we have the value of all the three terms, and so we are ready to evaluate the expression, and it all adds up to be pi by 6. I hope with this question and the rest of the explanation, the concept of the principal value branch of inverse trigonometric functions is now clear to all of you. Do pick up your book, try out the first exercise, and see if you can manage all of these questions on your own. I hope to see you again in our next episode. Thank you.